हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम बैक। माय सेल्फ पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद आवर डेली करंट अफेयर्स। सो टुडे यू हैव द 16th of February 2021 एंड वी आर बेसिकली यू नो गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद आवर क्लास फॉर डेली करंट अफेयर्स। सो दिस क्लास इज बेसिकली यू नो वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट और वेरी यूजफुल फॉर दोज स्टूडेंट्स हु आर प्रिपेयरिंग फॉर द सिविल सर्विसेज एग्जामिनेशन कंडक्टेड बाई द UPSC और अदर गवर्नमेंट कॉम्पिटेटिव एग्जामिनेशन, बिकॉज यू रिक्वायर टू आंसर few questions related to your day-to-day current affairs. So here you must read the national newspaper like the Hindu or Indian Express. Both of these newspapers are equally good. You can refer any of these newspaper. I would suggest you to read the Hindu newspaper. And apart from that, we are also bringing the daily current affairs day for our day-to-day coverage related to the current affairs. So you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube also, that is Future IAS. And you will receive the current affairs related basically lectures on the day-to-day basis on the YouTube. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first is basically the leatherback sea turtle. So what is that leatherback sea turtle? The leatherback sea turtle is basically a species of a turtle. So which is basically one of the largest, you know, population of the turtles, which are found basically in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands of India. So you can say this is, you know, the most long ranging species of the turtle. Why it is named as the leatherback turtle? Because its back looks like as if it is made up of leather. So it is leather look. That is why it is known as the leatherback sea turtle. So here a development plan which was proposed by the Ministry of Tourism, right? So that plan basically, you know, certain conservationalists as well as, you know, environmentalists basically objected to those proposals related to certain port development and tourism related, you know, infrastructural development, especially in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands, that would basically affect the breeding population of those leatherback sea turtles. So various conservationists as well as environmentalists basically worried about the fate of these leatherback sea turtles, which may be impacted because of such infrastructural development, especially in the Andaman and Nicobar Island. Because the leatherback sea turtles are found in the larger numbers, right? They have the nesting populations, especially in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Okay. The leatherback sea turtles are basically also known as Dermocheles coriacea. Right, it is the largest of the 7 species of sea turtles on the planet. So it is basically the largest among the 7 biggest species of the sea turtles that are found right on the planet, and it is the most long ranging species of the turtle, which is found almost in all the oceans, because it is basically the long ranging which can migrate also, okay, except Arctic and Antarctic. That means it is not found in the colder areas. Preferably it is mainly found basically in the oceans, both in the Atlantic Ocean, Atlantic Ocean, Pacific Ocean, as well as in the Indian Ocean. If you talk in terms of Indian Ocean, they are mainly found in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands that belongs to India. Apart from that, its nesting sanctuaries are also found in the Indonesia as well as off the waters of Sri Lanka also. Okay, and it is the only living species of the genus Dermocheles, right? And it is basically belongs to the family of Dermocheleidae. Okay, and you can easily differentiate this leatherback sea turtle by the back, right? So it is having, you know, some sort of a bony shell, right, which looks like as if it is made up of leather. So that is what the name leatherback turtles have came. Okay, and its carapace also is covered by the skin and oily flesh also. Regarding its, you know, its protection, it has been listed in the Schedule 1 of the India's Wildlife Protection Act, which provide the categorization of the animals in the schedules of the Act under Wildlife Protection Act, which provide some sort of a protection to the species which are listed in the Wildlife Protection Act. So Schedule 1 of the species basically have been protected the highest legal protection according to the Wildlife Protection Act. So this leatherback sea turtle is also provided the highest level of protection, right, or highest level of legal protection from being poaching related activities. All right, And in the budget 2021, a National Marine Turtle Action Plan was basically released. So here, the National Marine Action Turtle Plan, which was released specifically for those areas which are the important nesting habitats of the marine turtles, especially. So this Marine Turtle Action Plan is basically also applicable to the Andaman and Nicobar Islands, right? This action plan was released on the February 1st, 2021 by the Ministry of Environment for the protection, for the safeguarding, the nesting species of, you know, the leatherback sea turtle. And this plan is also, according to that plan, the India has identified the important sea turtle nesting habitats, okay? This sea turtle nesting habitats will be called as important coastal and marine biodiversity area. So they are known by this name, important coastal and marine biodiversity area, which are important sea turtle nesting habitats, right? Where this type of sea turtles can be easily found. Okay. And they are basically included, you know, in the coastal regulation zone one for their maximum protection given under coastal regulation zone. Okay. Regarding their species, which are found basically in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. So you can easily found in the South Bay and the West Bay on the Little Andaman Island, right? You can also found in the Galatea on the Greater Isle, Greater Nicobar. And also you can easily find out, you know, these species, right, on the beaches in the island, right? And here you have the important marine and turtle habitats in India, which are also the most important coastal and marine biodiversity areas where you can easily find out this leatherback sea turtles. And the largest leatherback sea turtle grounds are found basically in India, specifically in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. So that is the reason the various conservationist group basically objected to the developmental plan, right, to the port development plan, as well as other tourism related infrastructural development plan, right, in the Andaman and Nicobar Island, because it will affect those species of the sea back, or those species of leatherback sea turtles, especially on the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Okay, so you can see here the back, it is basically the bony and leathery look, so it is also known as the leatherback sea turtle. Okay, it is the largest among the seven species which are found on the planet, and it is also the long-ranging species of the sea turtle. It is found in almost all the oceans except Arctic Ocean and Antarctic Oceans. Okay, next is Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala. It is the name for a female. Okay, it is basically the name for the Nigerian former prime minister. The Nigerian former prime minister who was also holding, you know, that rich experience of 25 years of the working with the World Bank. Okay, now the World Trade Organization had chosen the Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala as the director general for the World Trade Organization for the next 4 years. Okay, so she would be the first female and first African leader, belongs to the Nigeria. So she has basically the dual citizenship. She has basically both Nigerian citizenship as well as the United States of American citizenship. So she has both the citizenship with her. And the Ngozi basically would be the first female and first African leader who would be heading the post of Director General of World Trade Organization, all right, which is a basically rule-based global trading system, all right. So here the World Trade Organization's 164 members unanimously selected 66-year-old economist called Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala for the 4-year terms as a Director General of World Trade Organization. Okay, the previous president of the United States of America, Donald Trump, basically, you know, blocked the move of appointing Ngozi as a Director General of World Trade Organization, but the current president of the USA, who is basically the Joe Biden, has given his green light, right, for the appointment of the Ngozi as a Director General of the World Trade Organization. So the appointment came after the Joe Biden basically endorsed, you know, her candidacy as the, you know, Director General of World Trade Organization. Okay. And regarding her career, she basically served also the Nigeria's finance minister, right? And she has also around 25 years of the rich experience with the World Bank. Okay, So almost 25 years she is working with the World Bank. Okay, and she has been rising right to the number one position as a managing director of the World Bank also. So obviously she has a rich experience of working with the international bodies, specifically the World Bank. And she's basically holding both the US and the Nigerian citizenship, right? And regarding the World Trade Organization, the World Trade Organization is basically an international body which basically deals with the rule-based trading system between the nations, okay? So it basically, safeguard basically the rights of the nations regarding the rule-based trading, as well as, with the different agreements which was signed among the member countries within the WTO framework. They are basically negotiated and, ratified by the legislatures of the different countries. So it is basically promoting the orderly trade among the countries and also safeguarding the rights of, different countries based on the rule-based, trading system in the world. All right. So she is basically the Ngozi who would be, appointed as a Director General of the World Trade Organization for the next 4 years. She is basically belongs to the Nigeria, and she is also holding the citizenship of USA. Okay. Next, the geospatial sector in India. So what is geospatial? Geo means earth related. Okay. If you see, geo means earth related. Okay. Spatial means with distance. With distance or with space. Okay. So here you will be getting the information related, related to the earth with the space. So roughly you are collecting the data. You are collecting the data, right, related to certain events, related to certain phenomena, or, certain objects, right, that have a location, on the surface of the earth. Okay. That is basically called the geospatial data. So geospatial data is any data which is related to the object, event, or even phenomena also, right, which is having a location on the surface of the earth. That type of data is called basically the geospatial data. Now, this geospatial data is basically managed by or regulated by the geospatial sector. Now, the Ministry of Science and Technology basically released a new guidelines for the geospatial sector in India, right? So these new guidelines will be, right, for regulation of this geospatial sector in India, right? Basically, these guidelines try to deregulate the existing protocols which were already regulating or over-regulating the geospatial sector in India, right? And these guidelines are meant to liberalize this sector from basically excessive over-regulations, so that it can become the more competitive field, so that it can be used for various purposes. Okay, regarding the definition, as I told you, it is basically, geospatial data is any sort of a data which is related to the object, events, or the phenomena which is, having certain set of location on the surface of the earth. Okay, so these location may be, static means at that one place. So any phenomena or any object may be located at one place. Okay, for example, you can find out easily the location of a road, right, which is basically fixed. The static means it is fixed. Road cannot move, right? So it is a fixed location. So to find out the location of the road, isn't it? Exactly pinpoint the location of the earthquake, okay? Earthquake event, where the earthquake occurred, okay? You can easily find out the malnutrition among the children at one particular place, isn't it? So have one location where you can find out, or you can basically, make a graph for, finding out the malnutrition among the children. Or these are basically static, that means fixed. The dynamic means something which is moving, So for example, you can also, collect the data regarding the phenomena or regarding the events. For example, if there is a moving vehicles, right, on the road, or you can also find out the pedestrians basically movement, right? Or you can easily, capture the data related to the infectious disease, which can spread very, very fast. For example, you have the, contagious disease like COVID-19. Right, to collect the data related to that type of dynamic, event or dynamic phenomena is basically also can be captured through the geospatial data. So geospatial data can capture both the static event as well as both, you know, dynamic event. The static event may be anything which is fixed, right? And the dynamic is something which is spreading or which is moving. The moving vehicles, the moving buses, right? You know, any sort of the movement on the foot, or, you know, spreading of disease or spreading of contamination or whatever may be, right? Which is dynamic, which can also be, you know, captured through the geospatial data. Okay, now the geospatial data basically combines the locational information. Okay, at what place this type of data is collected. So obviously the locational information is most important. Okay, then attribute information. For example, any particular object, for example, a road or a pedestrian or the disease, right? So attribute information, that means a characteristic of a particular phenomena, whether it is a contagious, whether it is a fixed, right, whether it is a movable, right? So characteristic information is most important, right? And also the temporal information. Temporal means with time, right? So at what time its location is this. So if it is dynamic, right, how often it is spreading or how often it is moving. So the temporal information also. So locational information, its characteristic information, its temporal information. Okay, all three information are basically, you know, captured through this geospatial data. Okay, now these geospatial data usually involve basically, you know, information which is something related to the public interest, because you must understand that no such private information is captured through the geospatial data. Okay, only the public information or that information which is of public interest, which is of public interest or which is basically used by the public. For example, the locational aspect of the roads, localities, rail lines, water bodies, and public amenities will only be captured as a geospatial data. Okay, now you can easily find out the application of the geospatial data, which is used by, you know, various, you know, different apps. For example, you may be using the Swiggy or the Zomato, which is a food delivery apps, which they are using basically the geospatial data, right? And as well as the Amazon, which is also the e-commerce company, right? Amazon, Flipkart, all are using basically, you know, the geospatial data to target, the basically customers, right? Even the weather maps can also be made with the help of geospatial data. All right. So it is basically, you know, that type of geospatial data, which may be used for the locational aspect, which can be used for the locational information, temporal information, or to characterize some phenomena or event or object, you can also use the geospatial data. Okay. Next, the diesel and the petrol prices. So recently you have also heard about that the diesel and the petrol prices both have going up, right? The petrol basically touches in the Delhi is around 89 rupees per liter. The diesel price is also soaring high to 86.3 rupees per liter in the Mumbai. Okay, so both diesel and the petrol price is basically rising very high, okay, in our country. So that is happening because of the rising of the crude oil prices in the world markets or in the international markets, as well as the deregulation of those sector by the government of India. So obviously by deregulation, the retail prices of the petrol and the diesels are basically, you know, connected with the market driven prices. So they are basically connected with the market. So whatever if the crude oil prices in the market basically goes up, right, obviously the retail prices also would be goes up, right? So this would be basically, you know, related to the market prices of the crude. So here the government basically gave the reasons regarding the rising up of the prices of the petrol and the diesels. Basically, you know, the prices have risen more than 50% over $63.3, you know, dollars per barrel. So, you know, the price which was related to the crude oil has bent up by more than 50%. Now it is touching almost $63.3 per barrel, right, since October, and which is basically forcing the oil retailers, right, who is selling the oil, especially the diesel and the petrol, to increase the pumping price or to increase basically, you know, the price of petrol and the diesels. Okay, as I told you that the price of or retail prices of the petrol and the diesels are basically decontrolled. That means now they are related to the market price, or they are related directly to the market or the global crude oil prices. That means if there is a rise in the global crude oil prices, obviously there will be corresponding rise with the prices of the retail diesel and the petrol. But that may be also reverse, vice versa also. For example, if there is a decline in the price of the global crude oil, right, that should be corresponding to the decline of the retail, you know, prices of the petrol and the diesels also. But that generally does not happen. Okay, so that is basically in the theory we can easily deduce that if there is a rise in the, you know, global crude oil, obviously the retail petrol and the diesels prices of it also go up. If there is a reduction in the global crude oil price, right, there should be decrease in the prices of the retail, you know, the petrol and the diesel. But that does not happen. So it is, in India specifically, it is a one-way street. Why it is called one-way street? It is called one-way street because what happens is whenever the global crude oil prices goes down, right, what happens is government all of a sudden, right, try to, you know, impose, you know, fresh taxes, levies, right, so that the government can accrue the maximum amount of revenue out of it. So who is the winner? It is the government, right, who is basically the winner of this, you know, subversion of this price decontrol, right? It is the government who is ultimately winning in terms of getting extra revenue by increase or decrease of the prices of the crude oil, right? But ultimately the loser is consumers, right? Mostly the, you know, the consumers also, the retail companies also, fuel retail companies, right? Both are at the losing end because the fuel retail companies has no option but to increase the price. Ultimately, that price has to be borne by the consumer, right? So we people generally borne the price. If the price, you know, shot down, obviously the government will get the extra money, right? In terms of, you know, levies of taxing, or in terms of, you know, putting extra revenues. So government will ultimately the beneficiary. And in India, it is a one-way street, right? Obviously, if the crude oil goes up, the retail prices also goes up. But if the crude price goes down, the retail price won't go that much down with this corresponding to, you know, the crude oil prices in the world market. So it is because of the imposition by the government of excess or some, you know, fresh taxes or the levies on the basically crude oil, which is basically, you know, ultimately borne by the consumers or the fuel retailing companies. All right. Now, if you want to track out the prices of the Brent oil or the crude oil, you can basically find out that it was around $40 per barrel. Sorry, it was around $40 per barrel between the June and October. Okay, and it started rising in the month of November. Now it has gone to, you know, beyond 60 per barrel. Now today it is $63.3 per barrel, right? So which is basically, you know, due to the, you know, rollout of the COVID-19 vaccine. So now because of this vaccine, you know, all sort of a developmental activities have gone up. And which is also rising, which is also demand, which is also, you know, increases the demand of various types of other, you know, transportation facilities. Now this is the one side of explanation why this global crude oil prices have gone up because of excessive demand. Now, the second side of this, you know, reason of increasing this crude oil price is, you know, cutting down of the production of the crude oil also, right? So this is deliberately cutting down of the crude oil production, especially, you know, the Gulf countries. So the, you know, amid rising demands for the crude oil, the controlled production of the crude is one such factor of increasing the prices of the crude oil. Okay. For example, Saudi Arabia, which is a major producing country or major crude oil producing country, voluntarily cutting down its daily output by 1 million barrels per day. So voluntarily it is cutting down. Okay. Now this has increased to around 8.125 million barrels per day. So that is deliberately cutting to increase the prices of the crude oil, and which is basically ultimately beneficiaries or benefit goes to the Saudi Arabia, obviously, by increasing the prices of the crude oil by cutting down the production or by controlled production of the crude oil. And ultimate, you know, loser are those countries, especially who are dependent on the crude. For example, India also around 80% or 83% of the crude oil is basically imported from the, you know, some of the Gulf countries. So India is heavily dependent on the crude oil, especially on the import, right? And you know, high amount of the forex or foreign exchange basically paid out for the purchasing of the crude oil, right, from these countries. And ultimate beneficiaries are those countries who are producing and exporting the crude oil to the countries like India. Okay, next is Vasant Panchami and Saraswati Puja. Both are basically celebrated on the same day, right? But in the different parts of the country. So basically, you know, the Vasant Panchami that we call, or the basically, you know, Saraswati Puja marks the beginning of a spring season. Okay, you have the seasons. So it is the beginning of the spring season, or it's the first day of the spring season. Okay, you can say the Panchami means it is a fifth day. That means it is in the month of, you know, Magh. Magh is a month basically in the Hindi calendar. So it is a Panchami of Shukla Paksh in the Magh month. Okay. Now this day is also celebrated as a Saraswati Puja. So Saraswati goddess is basically worshipped during Vasant Panchami. Okay. The Saraswati goddess is also known for the, you know, the goddess which provide the wisdom, knowledge, right? And you know, Saraswati goddess is basically worshipped on the day of Vasant Panchami. Okay. This day is basically, you know, very, you know, popular in basically in the West Bengal, Odisha, and northern states like Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Rajasthan, and Madhya Pradesh. So the Saraswati Puja is celebrated in almost, you can see, in the northern part of India, specifically UP, Bihar, Rajasthan, and MP, as well as the Bengal, Odisha, and some of the adjoining states also. Okay, fine. Then Sandis. Okay, it is basically, you know, the app, which is basically a messaging app, which is launched by the National Informatics Center. Okay, so it is a messaging platform just like a WhatsApp. Okay, it is a messaging platform just like a WhatsApp, which is launched by the National Informatics Center. Why the government is launching that type of apps nowadays? Because it is having certain set of, you know, security related, you know, implications, right? We are dependent heavily on the WhatsApp or other, you know, platform which may use our information for, you know, for other purpose also, for the security related, you know, breaches may be there, right? So excessive dependency on certain apps which are not controlled by the Indian agencies are definitely can be hampered, you know, the Indian security apparatus, right? For that purpose, the National Informatics Center basically launched the app that is called Sense. Okay, that app is also the messaging platform just like a WhatsApp. Okay, now just like a WhatsApp, this platform, which is also known as Sense, can be used for sending all type of information. Okay, just like we use basically with the help of mobile number or the email ID, so we can register on the Sense, right, by the, you know, by the mobile number as well as the email ID, and we can always use this platform to sending all type of information. Okay, right, and it is basically instant messaging app just like a WhatsApp. You can send it information and that will be received by the other person. Okay, similar to various other apps which are available in the markets like WhatsApp. Okay, now if you see basically the two platforms which are there, for example, the WhatsApp and this government instant messaging system, which is also known as Sense. So is there any sort of a, you know, the facility related to the transferring of the chat history? No, there is no such option. You cannot transfer the chat history between the two platforms. Definitely, it is basically, you know, the government is sending messaging system just on the patterns of the WhatsApp, but you cannot, you know, use that facility to transfer the chat history. But obviously, you will have the option of backing up those messages by using, you know, your email ID. So it is an instant messaging app in the market. You can use it right from basically from the Google platform, where you can get it, you know, or you can get it and you can get registered with your valid mobile number as well as with your email ID. Okay, and it also provides certain features like group making, broadcasting messages, right, message forwarding, you know, just like a WhatsApp, as well as it also provides the emojis which are generally sent by the people during the chat. Okay, so it is basically a government instant messaging system on the platform or on the pattern of the WhatsApp, which is basically, you know, promoted by the National Informatics Center, Government of India, for the uses of, you know, just like instant messaging system or instant messaging platform right, which can be an alternative of WhatsApp. Okay. So SENDS, which is government instant messaging system. Okay. Next is Devendra Kula Velalar community. So this is basically community, the Devendra Kula Velalar committee, basically found in Tamil Nadu. Okay. So Devendra Kula Velalar community found in Tamil Nadu. Now, now there was, you know, a news, or there was basically an hoax news or a false news, which is circulating in the media, that the Devendra Kula Velalar community, which already comes in the scheduled caste community or in the scheduled caste list of Tamil Nadu. So you might be aware that you have two lists, right? One is the central list of scheduled caste or central list of scheduled tribes, as well as you will have the state list also, because the reservation is given in the states based on the corresponding population of scheduled caste and scheduled tribe at the state level or the state wise. Okay. At the center or at the central level, you will basically consider the all India percentage of scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. Okay. So state wise population for the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe basically varies from state to state. For example, in the Punjab, all more than 30% of the population belongs to the scheduled caste. But if you come to the Rajasthan, it is around 12% of the population of the Rajasthan belongs to the scheduled caste. For example, if you say the scheduled tribe population in all India average is around 7.5%. But if you come to the Rajasthan, the scheduled caste scheduled tribe population is around 16%. Right? So, sorry, it is around 12%. 16% reservation for the scheduled caste in the Rajasthan. And 12% population belongs to the scheduled tribe in Rajasthan. In Rajasthan, I'm talking. But at the central level, you see 7.5% of the population belongs to the scheduled tribe. So again, I am just emphasizing or giving you example so that you can understand that there are two lists. One at the central list, which also correspond to the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe population. And state-wise, different lists are there. Okay. Now, this Devendra Kula Velalar communities are basically, you know, incorporated as a scheduled caste population in the Tamil Nadu. Okay. Any change in the state list also cannot be done by the state government. It can be done only by the parliament. So now the Ministry of Social Justice and the Empowerment is basically clarifying that the reports are baseless, that you know, deleting this Devendra Kula Velalar community from the list of scheduled caste Tamil Nadu list. Okay. That is completely, you know, a misinformation which is circulating in the media. Okay, so the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment clarified that it does not reflect the actual position which is circulated on the media. Okay, recently what happens is the Union Cabinet has approved categorizing of 7 SC community into Devendra Kula Velalar community. Okay, now what is happening is there is a scheduled caste list of, you know, in the Tamil Nadu. So you can say Tamil Nadu scheduled caste list, right? In that Tamil Nadu scheduled caste list, the Devendra Kula Velalar communities are there, right? The 7 such SC communities will be categorized as a Devendra Kula Velalar community, which will be included in the scheduled caste list of Tamil Nadu. Okay. Now, there is circulation in the media that the government is trying to delist, right, the communities from Devendra Kula Velalar community in the SC list. But that is totally baseless according to the Ministry of Social Justice and the Empowerment. Okay. The news is also flashing, right? The misinformation is also, you know, circulating that instead of listing into the SC community, the Devendra Kula Velalar community will be listed as a OVC community, right? As a OVC, other backward classes, but that is completely baseless, incorrect information that has been circulating. Now, the ministry also informed, right, through its clarification that the government has, or the cabinet has already approved the bill, all right, which is basically categorizing this 7 SC communities into Devendra Kula Velalar community, and that bill is already introduced in the Lok Sabha, right, for changing in the Tamil Nadu scheduled caste list, right? For that, the bill has already been introduced in the Lok Sabha. All right. Next, the oil and gas, the projects in the Tamil Nadu. Okay, so here the Prime Minister Narendra Modi recently visited the Chennai or the Tamil Nadu. Okay. The Prime Minister Narendra Modi dedicated to the nation various developmental projects, or the Prime Minister Narendra Modi also laid the foundation stone for the different key projects related to the oil and gas sector, especially in the Tamil Nadu, on the 17th February 2021. Okay. So here, the various such projects which have been dedicated to the nation by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi are First is basically the Ramanathapuram Thoothukudi natural gas pipeline. Okay, the Ramanathapuram Thoothukudi natural gas pipeline is basically a part of the Ennore, Tiruvallur, Bengaluru, Pondicherry, Nagapattinam, Madurai, and Tuticorin natural gas pipeline. So first of all, the Ramanathapuram and Thoothukudi natural gas pipeline is a basically 143 kilometers stretch of the Ennore to Tuticorin pipeline, or which is a natural gas pipeline, okay, which have been laid at the cost of around 700 crores rupees. Okay, this pipeline would basically utilize the gas from the ONGC gas fields, okay, where the natural gas will be captured and will be transported through this line, okay, and this natural gas would be used as a input for various, you know, different industries and other commercial customers also. So here the natural gas will be used as a feedstock for the industries. For example, there may be fertilizer plants which are dependent on the natural gas also, or the natural gas can be used as an input for various industries, right, as well as the commercial customers can also be using the natural gas as a energy resource. All right, and next is basically the gasoline desulfuration unit. The gasoline desulfuration unit have been dedicated, right, at Manali, Tamil Nadu, right, which is basically, you know, a unit of Chennai Petroleum Corporation Limited, okay, CPCL. So it is a dedicated unit for desulfuration of the gasoline. Why we are desulfurating, right? We are desulfurating so that we can produce the low sulfur gasoline, okay? So the gasoline which is normally, you know, comes out, which will be further desulfurated, okay, so that a low sulfur, which is around 8 parts per million ppm, okay, less than 8 ppm concentration of the sulfur will be produced. That concentration or that low concentration of the sulfur would be, you know, environmental friendly, okay. That low concentration would reduce the emissions, okay, related to the sulfur, and that will contribute towards the cleaner environment. Now you must understand, the sulfur pollution is also most important, because the sulfur react with the, you know, the gases in the environment and produces the sulfur dioxide, okay. The nitrous oxide, sulfur dioxide, which basically can cause the, you know, the acid rain also. You have the H2SO4, which can, you know, react with the water vapor present in the atmosphere, and that can produce, you know, the acid rain also, especially in on the industrial towns where the excessive amount of the you know, NO2 and, you know, SO2 is basically produced. So you can easily find out that the gasoline desulfuration unit of the Chennai Petroleum Corporation Limited would be of immense useful for the cleaner environment, for controlling the climate change. Okay, it will produce the low sulfur gasoline, which will be help in the, you know, containing or controlling the environmental change because of sulfur pollution. Okay, then Prime Minister Narendra Modi also laid the foundation stone of the Kaveri Basin Refinery at Nagapattinam. Okay, so Kaveri Basin Refinery have been, you know, started, so he has laid the foundation for that. Okay, this Kaveri Basin Refinery will have the capacity of 9 million metric tons per annum. Okay, this 9 million metric tons per annum, right, would be a joint venture of Indian Oil Corporation Limited and Chennai Petroleum Corporation Limited. So it will be a joint venture, right, of IOCL and CPCL, and it will have the estimated cost of around 31,500 crore, right? It will need that much investment. Okay, this capacity of 9 million metric tons per annum of this, you know, Kaveri Basin Refinery would produce the motor spirit and the diesel which is meeting the BS6 specifications, right? And also it will produce the polypropylene as a value added project, which can be used for the various industrial applications also. So the Prime Minister Narendra Modi has led various developmental projects, right, is also dedicated various projects to the nation, right, especially in the Tamil Nadu, right, during his visit to the Tamil Nadu. Okay, so it is the pipeline. You can see the pipeline of, you know, the gasoline desulfuration unit of Chennai Petroleum Corporation Limited. Okay, next is Ajmer Sharif Dargah. So every year, you know, the Urs festival is celebrated on the Dargah of Khwaja Moinuddin Chisti, which is basically a Dargah which is located in the Ajmer, Rajasthan. So this year, 809th Urs of Khwaja Moinuddin Chisti would be celebrated, in Ajmer, Rajasthan. Okay, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi has handed over a chadar. This chadar will be offered as a Ajmer Sharif Dargah, as a you know devotion from the Prime Minister Narendra Modi to the Khwaja Moinuddin Chisti. So this Ajmer Sharif Dargah, which is basically a Sufi saint, right? This Khwaja Moinuddin Chisti was basically a Sufi saint, so it is basically a Sufi shrine or the Dargah, which is basically famous for this revered Sufi saint Khwaja Moinuddin Chisti, right? Which is located as the Ajmer district of Rajasthan. Okay, and the shrine has the Chisti's grave. Grave means it is a makbara of the Khwaja Moinuddin Chisti. Okay, every year the Urs festival is celebrated at the Khwaja Moinuddin Chisti grave. It is basically an annual festival which is also known as Urs festival. Okay, and which basically commemorate the anniversary of the death of the Sufi saint Moinuddin Chisti, right? Which is a founder, which was the founder of Chistia Sufi order in India. Okay. And this celebration or the Urs festival or the anniversary of death anniversary of Sufi saint Moinuddin Chisti would be celebrated over 6 days. Okay. And during the night time, generally there will be a night long dhikr. There will be a Qabbali singing, right? Especially during the nights, and it will be celebrated over 6 days at the premises of Khwaja Nizamuddin Chisti Dargah. Okay. This anniversary would be celebrated on the 7th month of the Islamic lunar calendar every year. So this year it will be 809th Urs of Khwaja Moinuddin Chisti. Okay, so you can see basically the decorations of Khwaja Moinuddin Chisti at the Ajmer, Rajasthan, India. All right, then Ajay Mathur. So here the International Solar Alliance, basically, which is an international body, okay, or international organization, has announced that Dr. Ajay Mathur would be its new director general, right? After basically the Upendra Tripathi, who is basically going to retire, right, from the director generalship of the International Solar Alliance. So the Ajay Mathur would be appointed as a new director general of International Solar Alliance, right? The Upendra Tripathi was basically the first director general of International Solar Alliance since its inception in 2015. Okay, currently the International Solar Alliance has 73 members. So currently the International Solar Alliance has 73 members. Okay, and International Solar Alliance is an international organizations which promote the clean energy, or which promote basically the solar energy throughout the world. Okay, it was established in 2015 with the effort of Prime Minister Narendra Modi, as well as with the effort of the President of France. So it is basically the International Solar Alliance, which is basically accelerate the demand and the use of the safe and sustainable and affordable solar energy for all. Okay, so ultimate aim is to promote the affordable solar energy, which is also comparatively cleaner and a cleaner form of the energy, which can basically control the climate change which is basically happening adversely. Okay, an ultimate aim of International Solar Alliance is to mobilize over $1 trillion dollars of the basically money specifically for the investment in the solar project by 2030. Right, so $1 trillion of the money would be mobilized throughout the world, right, for various projects through advocacy, through policy, through regulatory support, right, and through capacity building. And it will be also try to minimize or overcome any sort of investment barriers related to the investment in the solar projects. So ultimate aim is to use the safe, sustainable and affordable solar energy, right? It will be accelerating the demand for the solar energy in the world. And the International Solar Alliance also try to mobilize $1 trillion of their money, right, for the development of this solar energy by 2030, right? It will be using the advocacy, policy and the regulatory support for mobilizing the $1 trillion of the rupees, as well as try to reduce any sort of investment barriers specifically in the solar energy field. Okay, so he is basically Dr. Ajay Mathur. All right, So thank you very much for attending this session. We will meet again tomorrow for our next current affairs. Till then, thank you very much for attending this session. Thank you.